In the headlines, women group protests rejection of gender bills at National Assembly. Three witnesses testify against suspected killer of Hanifa Abubakar. President Buhari approves $8.1 million to evacuate Nigerians as volunteers storm Ukrainian embassy in Abuja. And on the foreign scene, United Arab Emirates says Ukrainians eligible for visas on arrival as Russia assault on Ukraine continues. Hello and welcome to Trust News Update. I'm Darshan Hussaina Usman. Now the news in full. Women stormed the National Assembly complex on Wednesday to protest rejection of three main bills that seeks to support women representation in government, either in appointive or elective positions. Lawmakers on Tuesday voted against bills supporting gender affirmative action. The report.
These placard-carrying women protesters blocked the main gate leading to the National Assembly complex, saying they have come to the National Assembly to protest and ventilate their anger against the rejection of gender and equality bills. Leader of the group, Abiola Akiode, describes the rejection of the reserved special seats of 111 for women as wicked and inhuman, while calling on the federal lawmakers to revisit and vote in favor of the bills as a matter of urgency and necessity. The protesters also fought the voting procedure used by the leadership of both Senate and House of Representatives, leading to the killing of the bills.
It's a matter of power. When you are dealing with vulnerable groups, you feel that you have power over. You know, and you can do anything to that person.
Yes.
What we saw in the National Assembly yesterday, the disdain, the impunity with which the gender bills were thrown out and voted out, the noise we heard, well, you didn't show any form of remorse whatsoever. It was a noise that is telling us, what can we do?
Yes.
Who are we? Who are the women? What can they do? Which power do they have? So it's a noise that reduces us as human beings. It's a noise that affected our dignity as a person. And that's why we think it's important for us to say that this country belongs to all of us.
Yes.
We are co-owners in Nigeria.
Yes.
We are not minority group.
Mm-mm.
We are a majority group.
Yes.
The census population can say 49.7, but we all know that we have more women,
yes,
you know, than men in this country.
The Senate and House of Representatives, during consideration of the Constitution Amendment, voted against the special seats for women in Parliament. If passed, the bill would have created 111 extra seats for women at the National Assembly.
In the same vein, leaders of different women organizations stage a protest in Ilorin against what they term disappointment over the National Assembly's rejection of bills seeking more political offices for women. The protesters stormed the office of the deputy governor. The State Commissioner for Women Affairs is among protesters who submit a letter addressed to the leadership of the National Assembly. The woman said that non-passage of the women-related bills is disappointing and shocking, while threatening to make use of their numbers in the next election. Responding, the state's Deputy Governor Kayode Alabi urged them to ensure that they vote only politicians who are ready to do their biddings by improving on the number of posts allotted to them.
Affirmative action, then there won't be any voting in this country. We also want our women to be heard and seen at the same time. How can we be heard and seen at the same time? By rejecting the constitution bias. We are rejecting constitution bias. We are also rejecting the political bias. No women, no nation. So if the constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, 1999 as amended, does not take into consideration the position of the women, it's not good enough for us. We want our women who are married to men outside their states, after 5 years of marriage, to become indigenous of the states of their husband. Just like for men, when they marry women, the women become citizens of their various states. When our Nigerian women marry foreign men, we also want the foreign men to become citizens of Nigeria.
If you also check that population when day of election, you see more women lining up than men. What am I telling you, Honorable Commissioner? You have the power, you have the capacity to dictate to those at National Assembly. So if you can't get what you want now, then election is coming. Then ask those who voted against you, who refused to give you 35% like my boss did. Okay?
50%.
My boss is a very progressive-minded person. He gave us 35%, right?
50 now,
right? Good. So tell them, when they come to campaign, to you women, mobilize yourself all over Nigeria and ask them what are they going to offer you. Let them assure you that they offer you 35%. Before you vote for them, I can assure you they'll give you 35% next time.
Thank you.
So you have the power. We have the population, you have the numbers. So use that numbers in a positive way. And as you do, God will help us.
Minister of Women Affairs Pauline Tallon says women will use 2023 elections to achieve their set goals, even with the rejection of proposals to advance their cause in the National Assembly. She dropped the hint Wednesday in Abuja while fielding questions from State House reporters after announcing that the Federal Executive Council meeting had approved a revised National Gender Policy 2021 to 2026. The federal lawmakers on Tuesday turned down bills seeking special parliamentary seats for women in the national and state assemblies and 35% affirmative action for women in political parties administration in the proposed amendments to the 1999 Constitution.
We should remain resilient, and we have already put in place strategies. Last night we all met the key civil society organizations and other women activists. We are strategizing with the female members in the both houses of assembly, and I want to assure you that Nigerian women will not give up. We will keep pushing until we achieve the affirmative action. Other strategies are also put in place, which I will not disclose now. But we are putting strategies towards the 2023 elections. And we know what to do by the grace of God. A lot of our advocacy has been put in place, but they were simply bent on doing what they wanted to do. However, we are not giving up. We will continue to intensify advocacies right to the local government level, up to the ward level. And the outcome of our advocacy now will show by the time we go into the next election that is very much around the corner.
President Muhammadu Buhari has approved the sum of $8.5 million to evacuate at least 5,000 Nigerians who are stranded as a result of the ongoing war between Russia and Ukraine. The Minister of State, Foreign Affairs, Ambassador Zubairu Dada, said this Wednesday after the Federal Executive Council meeting presided over by Vice President Yemi Osinbajo at the Council Chambers of the Presidential Villa in Abuja. He said a joint memo on the money meant for the evacuation of Nigerians now in Romania, Hungary, Slovakia and Poland was presented by the Ministry of Foreign Affairs as well as that of Humanitarian Affairs, Disaster Management and Social Development and approved by the Federal Executive Council.
That the President has graciously given us approval, along with the Ministry of Humanitarian Affairs, to do the best we can to do the needful. In other words, to evacuate those Nigerians that are willing to come back home, a good number of them being students who may have been caught up in this war in Ukraine. And to say that Evacuating such a number is certainly not an easy task. But we're also not unmindful of the fact that some Nigerians may decide of their own not to even come back home. There are issues of resources involved, and this is where Mr. President's involvement has been very helpful. And that has enabled us to conclude arrangements to actually dispatch 3 aircraft to 3 different countries to evacuate our citizens. These countries include Poland, Hungary, and Romania. We have some numbers. I think in Poland we have about 400 Nigerians. In Hungary we have about 960, and those number and such numbers. And like I said, all these agencies are pooling resources to ensure that these aircraft leave today for these countries in order to evacuate our nationals from those countries.
In another development, some young Nigerians have approached the Ukrainian embassy in Abuja to volunteer their services to the Ukrainian government following calls by Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky on other nations to assist in its defense against the invasion of Russia. The volunteers explained that they would rather fight than continue to wait on the government to meet up their daily needs. Sagir Ibrahim was there and files this report.
I'm currently standing in front of the Ukrainian embassy here in the Federal Capital Territory, Abuja, and sitting by its gate right behind me are vibrant young Nigerians who have approached the embassy to volunteer their services to the Ukrainian government following the call of Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky to members of other nations who are willing to assist in his current defense and invasion by Russia. When asked why they had approached the Ukrainian embassy to fight for the country instead of their own, they had this to say.
We are angry. We are angry. So we want to leave this nation because some of all these men, their children are nowhere. Their children are not in this country. They are abroad, studying, have to strike here and there. I have volunteered myself if I want to leave this country. I want to go and fight for Ukrainians. I've enrolled into Nigerian Defense Academy for the past three consecutive times. 2013, I was there in Kaduna, Zaria. Even when my name was enlisted, they said I still have to have a link to a general or senator.
It's better for someone to even die there than to die in this country.
Yes.
My brother, is it anything special in this country? You and I know that nothing special in this country. If flash your back at least some years ago, what the bonus we met those things and those things are still on ground. Is that how it's supposed to be? Is it a country that are ready to move on? Traveling from here to Ukraine, to Ukraine and assist them in fighting, I believe is the best thing.
Is
the best thing that Nigeria
and
youth.
You
understand? And you'll be guaranteed. Even if you die there, I'm sure that your family will not suffer here in Nigeria.
Yes.
We have political crisis, we have economic crisis, we have issues here and there, we have insecurity, right? And there's no sign by the government that they are going to do anything soon because all this while they've been doing blame game. So some of us think that it's better to die for a country who will value you, right, than to die for a country who will not, even while you're alive, it seems as if you're dead already.
My dream has been to be in a military. That has been my dream. My childhood dream is to be in military, and it sinks. For the past, since 2012, I've tried savvily, applying for DXX, Navy, Army, Air Force. I've tried savvily. It's not one, it's not two. It's like consistent. In fact, I would say that all the applications that I've underwent in the Nigerian Army and paramilitaries, I've applied for all. but it's not working out. We think that we are not opportune to know people that I am in office, in public office. I am government, we are not opportune. That's the truth.
Their hope of a new future might, however, be dashed as they complained of lack of preparedness on the side of the Ukrainians.
For the news I heard online, what the thing stated that if you're willing, do you understand that a provision will be made for you and all that? Me hearing, it's a reverse, this is an issue I'm hearing now, that if you want to go, you should be the one to make a visa for yourself and all that, go to Poland, then they will know that, they'll see the readiness in you. To me, they're not ready.
They said that we that are willing to go there, we have to raise the sum of $1,000, which is about 500,000 naira. I was like, but that wasn't what you guys are telling us is totally different from what we read online. I don't think they are ready for that. They just want us to go and hustle for the money. If I have $1,000 here in Nigeria, I know the business, I will invest it. And in a month time, I will recover.
Unemployment, lack of opportunities, and lack of a favorable environment to do business were some of the reasons they gave. They say that until the government has put in place infrastructures to ensure that the sufferings of Nigerians are alleviated, it is better to die for another nation than their own. Sagir Ibrahim reporting for Trust TV.
Twenty-three local government councils of Kaduna State receive a total of 152 million naira as performance grant for local government fiscal transparency, accountability and sustainable program. Permanent Secretary at the State Ministry of Budget and Planning, Umma Aboki, in an interview with Trust TV's Fatima Zali Ladan, says the program is aimed at helping the local government to build capacity and improve the governance. You're still watching Trust TV News Updates. Coming up after the break, how would B nurse abduct neighbor's child? Do stay with us. Welcome back. You're still watching Trust TV News Updates. Let's take a look at some of our top stories. You heard that women stormed the National Assembly complex on Wednesday to protest rejection of three main bills that seek to support women representation in government, either in appointive or elective positions. You also heard that President Muhammadu Buhari has approved the sum of $8.5 million to evacuate stranded Nigerians as some youths storm Ukrainian embassy to volunteer their services to the Ukrainian government. In health, Nigeria Center for Disease Control says Nigeria has recorded 28 cases of COVID-19 in four states and the Federal Capital Territory. The agency's data showed 48 persons were discharged after they recovered from the COVID-19 infection, with no death reported on Wednesday, leaving the country's total fatality figure at 3,142. Nigeria has so far recorded 254,598 infections and 249,138 recoveries across the country. Residents of Yola, Adamawa State, are still in shock after police arrested one Blessing John, a JAM applicant for abducting a neighbor's 8-year-old boy with the intention of selling him in Mubi in hopes to use the proceeds to buy a car and house. Speaking, however, on her motives to Trust TV in Yola, Blessing, a native Omichika, says she planned to acquire a handset with the proceeds of the abduction. The report.
Abductions and kidnappings for ransom has been on the rise in the north. But the video of Blessing John, which surfaced online showing a teenager confessing to abducting an 8-year-old boy with the intentions of selling him a movie and using the proceeds from the sale to buy a car and a house, has riled everyone. The incident has also raised questions about the decadence in the society and the get-rich-quick syndrome that appears to have pervaded our social fabric. Blessing, who will soon be charged to court, according to the police, narrated the account to Trust TV with remorse.
How the thing started. I went to movie on September last year during the period of work. I went for the account for the opening of account in UBA Bank. So I met some guys in a house that I'm staying. Then they are busy discussing, influencing their friend, the easy way to get money. So after that, then I had everything they have done. Then the boy come and meet me and greet me. After that, then we make a discussion, small discussion, and he repeated the statement that they have made with their friends. So after that, then he gave me the number, if I have any interest in it. So after he gave me the number, I didn't try the numbers during this October, November, and December. It's just in this January ending, I decided to try the number that they have given me. Then I decided to come and register for JAM in movie. Then I took the child. After I took the child, since I have had the area where that they are doing it. So I came to the area, I asked a kidnapper provider, and he told me that he don't know the house, but he's going to drop me in the area. After he dropped me in the area, I didn't ask anybody. Then I still stop another kidnapper provider, and I go back. After I go back, I called one of my friends. After I called one of my friends, then I went to their house. Then he saw me with a small boy, and he told where are you going to with this child? Then I tell him that he is my junior brother. I took him from home. See the intention that I come to do with him here, but I haven't make it, so I want to return him back. So before I realize, he have returned it back and he reported me to the security.
The police in the state has said it is not leaving any stone unturned in the prosecution of the case to serve as a deterrent to other young persons, as cases of trafficking in person in recent times have spiked in the state.
And in the case of doing that, both human and material evidences will be gathered. And as soon as that is done, the command will going to ensure that she's prosecuted so that it can serve as deterrence to others from doing likewise.
Some residents in Yola who bear their minds on the growing spate of child trafficking in the state and proffered a way to end the menace.
On judicial matters, three prosecution witnesses testified before Kano State High Court against Abdulmalik Tunko and others accused of kidnapping and killing of 5-year-old Hanifa Abubakar by her school principal. Presiding Judge Justice Usman Naaba admits 10 exhibits presented by the prosecution team led by Kano State Attorney General and Commissioner for Justice Lowell Musa.
All were taken. And we've also cross-examined their witnesses.
For security reasons, of course, not everybody was allowed into the court. That is during the testimony of the first and second prosecution witnesses. These are witnesses that gave vital evidence on the case, how the whole investigation was conducted from the beginning, how the first, second, and third accused persons were arrested, and equally some exhibits recovered. And of course, you know, after their testimony, the court stood down the matter for like 30 minutes, 40 minutes, and then when we went back, everybody, you, all of you were part of it. The third witness testified, who is the police police investigator and inspector, who also narrated to the court how they conducted the investigation. The exhibit they also recovered together with the first exhibit that were recovered, and we tendered all those exhibits through him. So, and all these witnesses were thoroughly cross-examined by the defense team. So, like I said and like I told you, we are very much ready to prosecute this case in the shortest possible time. By the grace of God, tomorrow is another day because the matter was adjourned for 2 days That is today, second, and tomorrow, third. Tomorrow, hopefully, we have four more witnesses that we intend to call before the court. And depending on how it all goes tomorrow, probably we may ask for another short date so that we can bring our last witnesses. So as you can see, from the first day, these three accused persons were arraigned till today, it's not yet 1 month. And I assure you, if it continues like this, we'll be able to close our case within the next 1-2 weeks.
And finally, on the foreign scene, United Arab Emirates says Ukraine nationals are eligible for visas on arrival in the Gulf Arab state in an apparent reversal of a decision to suspend visa waivers to Ukrainians amid war in their country. Kyiv's embassy in the UAE had previously said that Emirati authorities had temporarily suspended the waivers as of Tuesday. Emirati Foreign Ministry in a statement said Assistant Under Secretary for Consular Affairs at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation, Faisal Litfi, had announced that the Ukrainian nationals continue to be eligible for visa on arrival to the UAE. Meanwhile, a pro-Russian separatist commander in Donetsk, Eduard Basurin, is threatening to launch targeted strikes on the port city of Mariupol unless Ukrainian forces surrender. And with that, we've come to the end of Trust News Update. Don't forget to follow us across all our social media platforms. I'm Dashen Hussaina Usman. Thanks for watching.